I want to thank you all for coming. I don't have an introduction for our guest speaker tonight. Just a quick story of how she ended here. Dr. Gary Clark, who was in our midst, Gary, raise your hand. Gary wrote a dissertation when he earned his doctorate, and it was entitled, Even the Books Were Separate. And I never read a dissertation whose title just jumped out at me. And he told the story of these six educators in Caddo Parish and their different perspectives on the crossover. My interest in the crossover led me to Gary. Getting to know Gary led me to Eileen. Getting to know Eileen introduced me to Freedom Lessons, and now she's here. So without any further ado, Eileen Sanchez, join me in welcoming her.
So I'm going to go over to the mic, but can you hear me for now?
Yeah.
Because I know my voice won't stay. But thank you so much for coming, and thank you for inviting me, and Chris, it's really special to be here. I just want to give you a little background about myself. I lived in Louisiana for 1 year.
The best year of your life.
Well, it was. It was my first year of marriage, and now we're married 50 years. My husband's over here.
That's awesome.
It was a very good start to our marriage and to our life. And because my title of my book, Freedom Lessons, you'll understand a little bit more as I introduce you to the story. But before I start, I was always a teacher. I retired after 40 years in education. I started out as a classroom teacher. I became what you would know as an educational diagnostician. In the public schools, and then I became an administrator at the end of my career. So in all of those years, I still feel like I'm a teacher. So if I get too teacherly, it's I'm sorry. you'll bear with me. That's just a little bit of an introduction to who I am and why I'm here. And so let me start.
Yeah, thanks. I gotta figure out which button to push.
Should
that
put
one.
It here?
Oh, yeah, okay.
Put it on the floor.
Okay. So these are the, can you hear me? No, that's not on. Okay, I think it's good now.
Can
yes.
you hear?
Yeah, okay. So these are the freedom lessons that I developed those. This is my first published book. It took me 5 years to write. A lot of research went into this. And at the end of, you get a publicist and they're telling you, giving you advice about what are your messages. And I really had to think about that. I thought I knew, but when I really started to think, this is what came out. These are the lessons that I believe that I learned from that 1 year that I taught in Louisiana. And these lessons are just really important and woven into the book. So, many of you, let me just see, who are students, undergrads? Okay, so you weren't even born when 9/11 happened. So
yes.
Some of you,
we were born.
But you were babies. So, there are events in people's lives that really impact them. And so what I learned to call the crossover really impacted my life. And many people here, this is the first time I've spoken to anybody outside of New Jersey about my book. And so in New Jersey, there's a different experience about integration. It wasn't as hard in New Jersey as it was here in Louisiana. And so many of the people will look at Ruby Bridges and understand her story, and maybe they know from history books what the integration was like and what does that mean. But as I've talked to people, especially younger people, and they say, 1969? That happened in 1969? What? Why wasn't, what are you talking about? They just don't understand. So that's the near, that's the, most people's experiences, unless from New Jersey. For me, my first memory of inequity in public schools struck fear into my 10-year-old heart. It was the images of the Little Rock Nine being escorted into the schools, and I saw this on TV. And then I would see it on the front page of the whatever magazine, Life magazine or Time magazine, or on the newspapers. And the one picture, the one image that really frightened me was of a young white student who was screaming. Her face was just ugly in its, the words that were coming out of her mouth, angry at the students that were moving into her school. And I, she looked to me like a neighbor, and I it frightened me to think that maybe she would start yelling at me like that. But I was a 10-year-old girl living in New Jersey. I was not a 15-year-old girl living in Arkansas. But 12 years later, I was a 22-year-old teacher. And for the first time in my life, working in the schools in Louisiana, I felt the prejudice and the discrimination that I had never experienced in my life. For the first time in my life, I was judged by the color of my skin. Even I was. I was judged to be somehow better. And that remained as a surprise. I thought that I was just doing a good job. But, whoops. On a November afternoon, imagine this, a young teacher comes off the playground with her class. They go into the classroom and she opens the door, and four men are standing in her classroom and they have clipboards. Now, who's a teacher here? And understanding that, whoa, I'm being observed. So I thought, that's unusual. But the principal was an African-American man. The other three men were white. I recognized one of them as the superintendent that had hired me. And they told me to go about my lessons. So the children sat down, and they were very reluctant, not really interested in what I was saying, or nobody wanted to talk. It was pretty awkward. And pretty soon the four men just left. At the end of that day, we were all called down to the cafeteria, and it was announced by the superintendent that at the end of today, when you go home, that do not come back to school. Go home, go to your classroom, get all your personal things, and tomorrow morning you will report to the white school across town. So that was on November 4th. So November 5th was the first day that we all went into the white school. So that teacher was me. And this is the 50th anniversary of the events in the book, Freedom Lessons. Now, it is historical fiction, and I'll explain why I wrote it as fiction as I go on. This is a picture of my classroom in the black school. When I've shown this picture in New Jersey, people are surprised. Why did they close that school? It looks like the schools that I went to. And in fact, it was not an old school. It was about 10 years old. It was a wing to the original school, which was the training school, which was a K-12 school that offered industrial and manual training for African-American students. But that was the classroom, and that is my class. So 3 months later, we started school in August. So in November, they moved me into a trailer classroom on the back property of the white school. I put the X's on the windows because my trailer didn't have any windows. Had one door, had air conditioning, and they moved all the desks and the books that I did have into the trailer. I had 24 children in the second grade in the black school. I had 30 in that classroom. They were actually in four rows. The rows on either end were right up against the wall, and the two in the middle were bumped up together so that there were just there was an aisle between them so they could get back to my desk or the reading section that I put in the back of the room. Our classroom was air conditioned, but the children were not used to air conditioning, so it was a struggle. It was a difficult year as I adjusted to this unfamiliar culture. I'm a Jersey girl. I don't know if you're not from New Jersey, you don't really understand what that means, but we're proud of being Jersey girls, and not the ones that, what's that show?
With the Housewives.
No, not that kind. No, but we like to go to the beach. We like to go, it's just, it was a very different culture for me to adjust to. And there were unwritten rules, I just didn't know. So everyone struggled through this mandated school integration. But I never forgot about the 30 students, the 30 second graders that I was forced to keep back in second grade at the end of that school year. So again, I'm gonna ask those of you who are teachers or any of you who were second grader, you were all a second grader. At the end of the year, I really felt like I let those children down. I had done my best, they had done their best, but no one really cared about that. There didn't seem to be any interest in the evidence that I had to explain their improvements. So why did I decide to write a book? 10 years ago, I was at a professional educational conference in New Orleans, and we were at Pat O'Brien's. Any of you have been there? So we had hurricanes, and we had the dueling pianos, and we were having a good time. And in between that, I mentioned to my friends, well, I've been here before. I lived in Louisiana and had been to New Orleans with my husband, and that I taught here. And they didn't know that. And these people knew me well in my professional life, but they had no idea. So one of my friends said that I really needed to write this down. I needed, at that time we had our first grandchild, she was 2 years old, and she said, you really need to write this down for her so that she knows. And I've since learned the importance of the date. October 28th, 1969 is the date and the anniversary of a lesser-known Supreme Court decision, Alexander v. Holmes. And that was the final straw that not just Louisiana, but Mississippi, Alabama, Texas, Florida, that they needed to integrate the schools if they had not done that already. So I always knew the impact that that experience had on my personal history and my personal story, but thinking about it that way made me realize how significant the event was in the history of our country. And I was a witness, and I needed to share what I experienced. So I needed to share it with my children too. They didn't know. They knew that, you know, mom and dad lived in Louisiana, but they didn't understand. So I started to wonder whatever happened to my students. When I started to write this, I did start out as a memoir. And when I did that, I realized that I was missing a lot of the story. I knew my story, I knew what I experienced. But I had returned to New Jersey at the end of that school year. I didn't know what happened to those children. There was no contact that I had maintained, and I really couldn't find out what happened. And then I started to do some research. One of the first things I learned was that public libraries were integrated before the public schools in Louisiana. But the practice of integration was not always the policy. In my book, I talk about a fact that when, in my experience in New Jersey with libraries, was that when in my town that I grew up in, when you ended first grade, you got a library card. And so my second graders, I expected them to have library cards. We didn't have a lot of materials in our class, and the library was an important resource for me to just get extra books in. And then I also wanted the children to have additional books, but they didn't have cards. So I went to the library to get them all library cards. But I was met with some resistance about that, and I can talk about that a little later. But I also, when I learned that Rosa Keller was the woman, and she was lived in New Orleans, and her husband was Jewish. So she experienced what prejudice was like through his eyes. And she was the one that really had a lot to do with libraries in Louisiana becoming integrated. So by the end of 1955, all the public libraries in the city were integrated, and many of the libraries in the state. And the library that I was using in the town that we lived in Louisiana was a federally funded library. So they also were integrated, but many of the patrons did not use the library, only the white patrons. So starting out to write a memoir and then deciding that you wanted to write the story of other characters was pretty hard. It was a huge challenge because I decided it didn't happen right away, but two of my main characters were African Americans. I needed to tell the rest of the story, not just mine. So it took a great deal of research to understand Frank and Evelyn. And I began my own personal Black history study, and what I learned I wove into their lives, into the story. I started my research in two New Jersey libraries. My hometown library connected me to a librarian in Louisiana. And through her, I found newspaper stories of the time. And most importantly, a dissertation titled, Even the Books Were Separate. So that's when I had this long list of books But just as you said, Michael, it just popped out. The title was just caught me. And when I read the personal narratives that were in this dissertation, it was the first time that I had affirmation of what had happened, what I had experienced, and I was able to read from other people's point of view. Very similar emotional experiences and the challenges of this, because I had never had anyone that I, it wasn't that I couldn't talk to people about it, but no one else had experienced it and they really had no clue. So I used a lot of internet research and I found out about all these topics, about sundown towns, segregation or Jim Crow laws. I had never read a list of Jim Crow laws. The Little Rock Nine I knew about, Black Korean War veterans, cold case suspicious murders, the history of black colleges, the importance of African American fraternities and sororities, integrated libraries that I've already talked about, and the history of African American funeral homes. So I wove those different pieces into my story to just give the characters, to make them as accurate as I could. So the black character that was a colleague, I created Evelyn Glover. I created her to be a friend that Colleen, my character, didn't have at the time, but had wished for. And Evelyn's family, I created her family to be a well-established middle-class family with a history of, they were college educated, they were teachers, and her father owned a funeral home. So it just gave a better sense of who the people that I worked with were. I created Evelyn to guide and challenge Colleen in the book. But this is a real Evelyn, who I named my character after, a friend that I worked with the last 15 years of my career. And that's why I named my character Evelyn for her. But here's how I use the information in a conversation in my book between Evelyn and Colleen. So it's still September, and Evelyn was a mentor to Colleen because Evelyn was an experienced teacher. She had been there 10, 12 years, and Colleen was a new teacher to the school and a relatively new teacher in her career. So Colleen was sitting at her table at the end of a school day, the second or third week of school, doing lesson plans without teacher guides. The classes, the black school teachers did not have teacher guides, and all the books were kind of falling apart. Well cared for, taped back together, but they were also older editions of any of the books, not new books. So Colleen is at her desk. Colleen picked up one of the readers and opened to the page with Dick and Jane hurrying to help their mother take the clothes off the line because it had started to rain. Colleen had taught from the 1965 edition in her last school. In it, a Negro family with twin sisters, Penny and Pam, and their brother Mike were friends of Dick, Jane, and Sally. Evelyn, Colleen said, this is a really old book, from 1956. Why don't we have the new edition? Evelyn's rare smile disappeared. We take what we get, and this is what we get. Did you look at the inside page? All the books came from the white school. When they get the new books, we get new ones too. Colleen felt her eyes widen. Evelyn shook her head. Don't look so shocked. Some folks should think we should be grateful that we have a Negro school at all, separate but equal. A friend of mine had to set up a new classroom in a white school this year, and she found out that they store the books in different stock rooms, colored in white. If they can't even mix the books, how do they think they can mix the students and the teachers? So that was how it felt at the time. And this was this Jersey girl who didn't even know the culture of the town. The use of the word Negro is because that was a term used at the time. And I do make that explanation in the front of the book. Frank became a very important character to tell the story from a student's point of view. When I was writing the book, I was in a writing class, and the instructor said, okay, next week, come back and write that scene from a different point of view. So the scene was the first day of school, or the first day in the integrated school. So I decided to write it from a middle schooler's point of view. I worked in a middle school, my office was in a middle school, I knew middle school kids pretty well. So I figured that was a safe bet to try and write it from that point of view. But at about the same time, I was also coming to another conference in Louisiana, because the Louisiana Association of Educational Diagnosticians, they have a lot of conferences. So I took that opportunity to come. I had been in touch with Gary because I was using his dissertation at the time. And on the same trip, I was able to go back and visit the town that I worked in. And through another educational diagnostician, I got to meet the principal of the school. She arranged that for me. Principal agreed to give me about 10 minutes in the morning, but she'd have to say the Pledge of Allegiance and lead the class in the opening exercises at 8:30. So my husband and I went to visit her, and she gave us 10 minutes, and she said, can you stay? And she invited me to stay. I was there for the rest of the morning, because when she found out that I was coming back and why I was coming back, she wanted to know more about me, and she showed me my old classroom. So the school has been reopened. It's now the middle school for this district. But one of the reasons I wanted to meet her was to find out whatever happened to those second graders. Because I left, I had to write a note to the parents and tell them that their children were being retained, and they weren't too happy with me. So that worked out. I was leaving at the end of the school year. I came home, but I never knew what happened to them. When I asked her, she said she didn't know anything about that. All she knew was that same year, the high school seniors were not able to graduate from high school. And she said that's why the town was so upset about the seniors, that the parents and, you know, the push was to get the seniors to graduate. What happened in the town was that the seniors were finally able to graduate. They graduated with a diploma from their school, not from the white high school that they moved into, which was fine with them. That was their school. So Frank became, it was her brother that wasn't able to graduate, and that's how I found out that these students were not able to graduate. So Frank became a character to tell that story. And then I made Frank part of the family, that there was a student called Rachel who was in Colleen's classroom. I created the family. Frank was a football player, very promising football player, and he was hoping for a college scholarship, but his father died in a tragic accident, and so he didn't have his father to support him, and he lost the opportunity to play football, so he lost the opportunity to get a scholarship. This was just all fiction, but based on some facts from the readings that I did from not just Gary's dissertation, but from other newspaper articles and other stories that I read. So I think, just to talk a little bit more, when the schools were integrated, this was November, so when all the black athletes and black cheerleaders and the student council leaders, any roles that they had, when they moved into the white school, understandably, those roles were filled. But there wasn't enough of an effort to actually help these students retain the leadership positions that they had. And so there's other parts of my novel that is based on fact about what students did to move that forward and how they finally were able to get some satisfaction. But Frank was a very strong character he had family values that were very important to him. He was there helping his mother because his father was no longer there. And he was very conscientious. And I got that feeling from the information that I read in part from Gary's dissertation. And so this is how Frank, when some of the students were doing, there were walkouts, this is what Frank did. So this was further in the school year. Let's see, when was it? It was in March. So the students had decided that they were going to have a walkout at noon. And Frank's girlfriend, who was a cheerleader and one of the leaders, was encouraging him to join them. His heart was racing. He had made up his mind. He sat back down at his desk. More students were leaving their classrooms, shouting and slamming doors. As he sat in his chair, his teacher sat on the edge of her desk. She looked at him a long time before she spoke. "Frank, you were on the football team, weren't you? I heard you were a star player at West Hill." That's the name of the school, the fictionalized name. "So, yes, ma'am, I was." "Well, don't you want to be heard too?" "Yes, ma'am, but I'm not going to miss class. I'm going to graduate and I'm going to college." Dr. Henson studied him. She ignored the white kids who were whispering and shaking their heads. And then she said, "Well, there's more than one way to succeed at something. All right, class, let's continue our discussion." So Colleen is the third point of view character. She's the white teacher, and she tells my story. I had to fictionalize Frank and Evelyn's stories to intersect with Colleen because I didn't really know these people when I was actually teaching. Sometimes when my husband would read some of my chapters, he'd say, "Eileen, that didn't happen that way." So I had to keep reminding him that it was fictionalized. But the experience of that year impacted my entire professional career. I've come to understand that at the end of the year when I had to retain the students, I became, as I told you, an educational diagnostician, and I also became a supervisor of the district supervisor for special education teachers. And any time a student would need some kind of help, you need evidence. You need to know what kind of help they need and why they need it. And it was just the decision when at the year that I taught these second graders, there was, it was based on thin air. So it really, I as I looked back and I realized that this is who I became. This is why I was who I became as a teacher, as an educator. But who I am, who I was at 22, isn't really that much different than who I am today. Perhaps I'm a bit wiser and not as idealistic, but I still expect that people believe in and follow the golden rule. This picture hints at what happened to Colleen when she was stopped by a police officer after she took four of her students to the library on a Saturday morning. It was my practice to take students to the library on Saturday mornings after I struggled to get them all library cards. And so this is an actual street in the town that I lived in 50 years ago. But the picture is more recent. So Colleen had just dropped the children off at their homes. What's a pretty thing like you doing way out here? Dark green aviator glasses, sunglasses hit his eyes. She couldn't work out his expression. I'm a teacher. He didn't let her finish. A teacher now, is that right? Officer, did I do something wrong? Well, now that depends. Why would a white woman be out driving in these parts? I took some of my students to the library and then I drove them home. He palmed her cards and walked to the look at the front of the car. New Jersey, you're far from home. His tone challenged her. There's no library out here. Colleen felt her throat constrict. She needed air, breathe. I took them to the library in Kettle Creek. Scrutinizing her identification, he rested his hand on his hip above his holster. She heard a creak as the leather strained across the pistol. No teacher of mine ever took me to the library. Are you collecting signatures or something? Signatures? What for? He handed Colleen her license and registration. Little lady, you're far from home, and you don't belong down these roads. We've had some nonsense with some of the church ladies coming out this way, with their northern people signing up the colors to vote. Don't come this way again, you hear? Or else you'll find there's a heap of trouble you know nothing about. So, I've written a story of one school year 50 years ago from three points of view, besides my own experience and my personal Black history research. I took the advice of Ellen O, CEO and co-founder of We Need Diverse Books, and Daniel Jose Older, an American fantasy and young adult fiction writer. I reviewed his 12 guidelines written for writers to ask yourself how you can respectfully write from the perspectives of others. Their advice is to tell the story properly or be prepared for criticism. So she, Ellen O, asks, do you need to tell this story? Then do it right. So it's my story too, and I did my best to get it right. Not sure that you've, oops, wait, I want to stay there. How do I go back?
Backslide.
What am I doing? Okay. Thanks. So I want to talk a little bit about the We Need Diverse Books, Teaching for Change. This is the teacher part of me coming out. Also, Graham's Book Club. The reason I started Graham's Book Club is that when I started to write this book, and one of my granddaughters actually wrote a review in the front of the book for me. I asked her to. She's now 15. She didn't know the history either. So I felt that I gave her some books that were, one of them was On the Road to Freedom, Turning 15, On the Road to Freedom, written by a woman that turned 15 on the road to freedom. So some other books of the time. And I've been looking for books for my grandchildren, and I encourage other grandparents, teachers, parents, to look for books that are diverse, that will teach you about diverse people that are different than you. That's what Writing the Other and Mirrors and Windows. You can read books that mirror who you are, and you can read books that give you windows into the experiences of others. When I read The Kite Runner, I learned about an Afghanistan youth that flew kites. Well, a little more than that, but I didn't know that. I didn't choose the book to deliberately to do that, but I've decided that it's a very good practice, and I would encourage all of you to do that. Lisa Libraries is a kind of a charity of mine that I'm encouraging. They donate books to prisons and to needy library places that might not have libraries. Then the other flyer, Diversity in Books, you can't see all the percentages, but the one on the far right is, it's 50% of children's books are written about white children. And then what is it? Something, 27% are about animals. So it's also encouraging writers of diverse cultures and ethnicities and races to write their stories. And so Teaching for Change and We Need Diverse Books support these people, to get other students out, books out for other kids. I'm doing things wrong. There I go. Just, this is, as you know, some of you have come up to me already and you have experienced the crossover in this town. So you know that there are commemorations in Louisiana about that, and people are getting together and talking and considering what happened and how are we doing. And so these are two examples of these people live in Louisiana. I don't know if you know their stories, but the We Miss Knowing Each Other, Ellie Brown and Natalie Adams, were third graders in 1969, 1970, and they were both like top students. And she tells the story about him, that when she started to realize that he was a pretty good student, she knew she had some competition, and she was worried. They graduated in 1980 from their high school, and they were both identified as, the top in their class, or most expected to proceed achieve. He is now an OBGYN. And she is a professor at a university. So they both did achieve as expected. They got together when StoryCorps, which is an online video that tells the stories of people, they got back together this past fall and met each other and realized what they had missed. They had missed a real good friendship. You know, they were competitors all through school, but they didn't keep up. The other story is about Coach, I'm going to say his name, Nagata. He was a Japanese man. I don't know if he was born here, if he considers himself Japanese-American, but he's the football coach of another high school in Louisiana. And when the same experience that they integrated the schools, he led his football team to support everybody and to just smooth the way, to make sure that everyone was welcomed. And if there were problems, he put his football players on it, and they helped the integration go smoothly. So I'm talking about him particularly because one person can make a difference. And we don't want this to happen, that they missed having each other as friends. One more teacher thing. So these two girls, your professors, the students that are here, have the book. I gave Dr. Hicks the book, Tell Me Who You Are. They graduated from high school in 2018. They took a year off with their parents' permission and with a lot of help to go around the country to talk about racism. As you see, they are, one is a Chinese, Winona is a Chinese, and Pyra is Indian. They went to school in the district that I worked in, the district that I retired from. That's why I'm in the picture with them. We had a convention in November. They were the keynote speakers at the New Jersey Education Association Conference. They were the keynote speakers at the National Education Conference in Houston last summer. They have a good story to tell. They want to encourage people to talk to each other. And they've realized in their interviews with other people, finding about what is racism? How did you experience racism? Do you know, do you experience that? That when they're asking people these kinds of questions, it's, you're telling, even if you've agreed to sit down and have an interview, you're probably telling somebody something that's pretty personal. And so they decided that these are not ego stories, but soul stories. So you're not just telling somebody where you work and how many children you have or where, you know, whatever you're telling about yourself that will fill your ego. You're telling a soul story. And I'm finding as I'm talking to people that I'm getting a lot of soul stories from people that attend my talks or read my books. And I've also decided that this is a soul story. It was hard to write. It was hard to write my part because I thought it was harder to write from the perspective of Frank and Evelyn, but it was really hard to write from my perspective because what am I revealing about myself as I write this book? And so, tell me who you are. I'll tell you one more story about, I was invited to speak to people in a group of women's group in the town that I grew up in. The town that I grew up in is not a very open-minded town. And the club that I was invited to speak to is not a really open-minded group. I was surprised to be invited there. I reminded my friend, what my book was about. Are they going to like it? It was a German club, I'll just say. And I'm not to offend anyone that's German here, but in my town, they are tough. So I did this pretty much the same talk that I just gave you. And I got some polite applause at the end, and I gave a gift of a book, and then it was over. And it was just like a very subdued group that I hope you're not going to be the same way, but as people were leaving, the woman that won the book came over to me, and she said, because I also talked about grandparents and, you know, needing to share these stories with your grandchildren and let them know, just to know about it. So she said, I'm going to read this book. I skipped something. My father, she said, left South Africa when he was 18. And he moved to the town, the next door, next town over. Raised a family. We were never allowed to speak to black people. I never spoke to a black person until I was 25 years old. I'm going to read this book, and I'm going to give it to my grandchildren. And then I knew why I was at that talk. It was just to talk to her. And so, you don't know. One person. There's a lot of things that we can change. In 50 years, there's still a lot of work to do. That's why these professors are working so hard at getting you to understand the soul stories, I guess. But I would like to give a book away today. So hopefully this will work. Whose birthday is February 20th? Anybody?
Mine's the 22nd.
Okay, you're close. Who else? Who's closer? Anybody closer? February 22nd?
Oh, that's closer than mine.
It's closer than?
Mine was 10th. Mine was Monday.
No, February 22nd is closer than to the 20th. Okay. Do you know what the February 20th is? The day of the crossover in Shreveport. So here you go. Okay, I talked too long.
Where did you teach in Louisiana?
In another parish.
Southern, north?
If we guess it, will you confirm?
No. I really feel like it's, if you read the book, you'll probably be able to figure it out. My husband was in the army.
Maybe say a little bit about why you don't want to.
Why I don't want to tell, it's just, it's, you know, I don't want to offend the people in the town, and it's because it's really not all of the stories are the culminations, the characters are, it's a culmination of events for Frank. I mean, stories that I knew about some of the situations in Texas, maybe something in Mississippi. But when you have the same stories over and over again, it just helped Frank's story to get fuller. Evelyn's story, the same. You know, the funeral home information that I read was really started in, I think it was in Alabama. It could have been. So it's just, I don't think it's, it's, I don't know that it's really helpful, and I wouldn't want, and I suppose, because the things that I talk about for myself really happened. So, you know, I don't want to I'd like to just keep it to be a story. Yes?
Did you ever find out what happened to the second race?
I did not. And they're 57 or 58 years old now. And that's the only reason I would like to go back and find out. Because I guess I would, I'll share something else why it's hard to, when you are actually talking to somebody about a personal experience and they might not want to share. I read an article in the newspaper in Virginia. My husband and I were in Virginia. I was able to call up the newspaper, find the school, because a group was also commemorating the 50th anniversary of their integration. This was last spring. And I tried to contact them because there was one story about a man was telling that he was not retained, but his sister was retained in second grade. And she's very angry, never got over it. And I wanted to talk to her. I wanted to just write her a letter or something just to tell her that maybe the teacher doesn't feel so good about that either. And I didn't get a response. So I tried. I went to the town. I tried to find out. I tried to get class lists. They had no records from that year. How could that be? So I wasn't, you know, I was getting some, people are uncomfortable about it. And that was not, that's not my intention to make people uncomfortable, but to just consider that you need to talk to each other and not miss the friendship that the two people that I showed you before missed. Any other questions?
Were you just told that they were not going to move on? Or were, I mean, what are we looking at? Or whether there just was no criteria? I mean.
There was no criteria. I was called into the principal's office and told that I needed to send letters home that I was retaining the class, that I was retaining the class.
Oh my gosh. Thank you.
It was not an uncommon practice, I found out later, but I didn't know that then. I mean, with the integration, and it kind of flies in the face of separate but equal. You're saying that this was an equal education, and now you're saying they're not meeting your standards. So it was very unfair. Any other questions? No. Michael?
Well, it's a lot to take in. You know, my approach would not have been to use the arts to really put some light on some real racial inequalities that existed in our state. It takes, I read this quote I shared with Chris, I believe, earlier. It takes bravery to be creative. And so there are a lot of painful things in this book. Some people have told me they, you know, have gotten through it, and it just, if they experience the crossover themselves, it's hard to recount that. And so whatever our feelings are, I just want to take this opportunity to say publicly, Eileen, I respect you as an author, but I admire you for your bravery. I admire you. And so I'd ask you all to just join me in showing a bit of admiration. Dr. Cicchetti and I want to thank all of our students for coming. Feel free to visit with Eileen, but thank you and have a good night.
Thank you.